Hello and welcome to Car Talk on National Public Radio with us, Click and Clack, the Tappert Brothers. And we're broadcasting this week from the Center for Birth Time Studies here at Car Talk Plaza. Recently, Tommy celebrated a birthday. We won't say which one it was. I mean, it's a secret.
I didn't know numbers went that high.
So we could call you from now on Heinz?
I didn't know that you could get numbers that high.
But it was interesting. I discovered from Mom and Dad that Tommy's birth time was 5 p.m.
Yes, and it has been known. It has been a known fact that, at least this is my theory, that the time of your birth has a profound impact on your future existence, your life, your attitudes.
It's obvious that 5 p.m. is the time that people get out of work, and you've been trying to get out of work ever since.
Yeah, but I found out that you were born at 10 o'clock in the morning, coffee break time, right? 11 Z's.
We discovered, we placed a secret call to the Bermans, and we discovered that Dougie was born at 1 a.m.
That's when everyone's what? Sleep. Just what does he do all day? He sleeps. No, I think it's true. I mean, I don't know if there's ever been any such theory proposed, but I wonder. This is how great research gets started, you know? Someone has a wacky idea.
And somebody will fund it.
Someone will fund, that's it. Yes. Maybe we can get NPR.
Well, we can't.
Murky research.
I was going through the files
the
other day, and as luck would have it, I came across an interesting letter from one of our listeners.
Oh, is this one here? Shall I read it?
Yeah, if you'd like to.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
Dear Car Talk, I just wanted to warn you that if you don't do something... This is Melissa again! If you don't do something about that show of yours, I might as well read the whole thing. I'm going to tell the EPA... parenthesis, Environmental Protection Agency, in case we didn't know what EPA went, to put a ban on your program. I am tired of you, not your, of you polluting the airwaves with all those dumb jokes. I'm going to get into it now. I think your show is absolutely awful, and I'm sure there are others who agree with me. It would also be greatly appreciated if you'd stop saying don't drive like my brother at the end of each program. I have never seen either of you drive, but it can't be that bad. Finally, you say that you run a mechanic shop. I don't believe you. Nobody in their right mind would let either of you work on their cars. The grammar here is awful. Signed, my pal, Melissa Peterson of Seattle, Washington. Don't forget the PPS is here. P.S., you might get more callers if you didn't insult the ones that you got. P.P.S., my dog hates your show, too.
I'm deeply disturbed by her letter.
You are.
Well, I'm a dog lover. And all the other stuff is true, but I can't believe the dog hates us.
Yeah, that's the thing that hurts the most.
It is. It hurts
I've never met a dog that I didn't like or who didn't like me, except that little one that bit me. You know, we know her name.
Anyway, if you'd like to talk to us, our number is 888-CAR-TALK. That's 1-888-227-8255. Hello, you're on Car Talk.
Hi, my name is Tina, and I'm calling from Long Beach, California.
Hi, Tina.
How nice for you.
Now, Tina sounds like she's going to be an easy caller. That she's whatever
I
we
am.
Say, she's going to go right along with
it. She's going to go along with it. And she's going to have a simple question. It's going to have to do with her husband and will be done in a minute.
You know, I don't have a husband, so I can't ask you
there
about
that. There
you go. I don't even have a boyfriend I can complain about.
You don't. What a sweet person you are.
All right, well, go.
You certainly sound like a sweet person.
Well, thank you.
Are you a school teacher?
You know, I'm a piano teacher.
Yeah.
Yeah, you have that...
You have that teacher quality about you.
That patient,
oh, thank
that
you.
Patient sound in your voice. And we'll see if we can try your patience in the next few minutes.
Yeah. All right.
What's the question?
I've got a 1997 Honda Civic DX. It's got a manual transmission. And in February, I drove up to Big Bear Mountain. And this mountain is really, really high. And then I drove back down. And I did something really dumb, which is that I left the car in neutral. On my way down.
Why'd you do that?
Because I wasn't thinking.
That must have been scary.
Well, you know, there was this yucky burning smell when I got down to the bottom.
Oh?
Which sort of clued me in that I had done something wrong.
Oh, so you were just doing this in the spirit of conserving gasoline or something.
No, I didn't do it. I just wasn't thinking.
Was accidentally in neutral, and you didn't notice that you were flying down that mountain?
Well, she didn't notice because she had her foot on the brake the whole time.
Yeah, yeah. And you were frying all the brake pads and the brake shoes.
So then for weeks, my brakes made this yucky grinding sound, and I brought them into my mechanic, and he said that I had glazed the brakes.
Yes, you did.
So, but here's the thing. I was talking to my friend last week, telling him the story of my stupidity and what it did to my brakes, and he said, actually, it's better to do that because it is better to do damage to your brakes than to leave it in first, because he said when you're going down a steep grade and you leave your car in first, it taxes the engine.
Don't speak to this person ever again. Whoever this friend of yours is, don't ever listen to him again.
Okay.
Especially if he wants to give you, like, medical advice.
Yeah. Don't ever.
Yeah, I wouldn't worry about that thing growing on the side of your head. That it'll probably just fall off.
No, he's absolutely wrong.
In fact, he couldn't be more wrong.
It's absolutely the worst possible thing you can do, because you're destroying stuff. You could have lost your brakes completely. It could have killed you.
Yeah, you're not taxing the engine. It sounds awful, I should add, if you're in first gear or second gear coming down a steep hill.
Yeah, it does.
It sounds, because the engine is screaming.
Yeah.
But that's okay, because it's as long as it's not going so fast that it's redlining the thing.
Okay.
And you would use the brakes intermittently, but you would rely mostly on the inertia of the engine to keep the car's speed reasonable.
Yeah.
But you never want to ride the brakes all the way down. I mean, you were very lucky that all you did was glaze them.
Yeah.
The danger is that they get so hot that the brake fluid boils, and then you have no brakes.
Yeah, that would be very bad.
So your friend gave you, and you got to correct him or her.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because that friend gave you exactly the wrong advice. You should do exactly the opposite of what he said. I'm going to assume it was a he.
It was a he.
Of course.
It's always a he. They know everything, you know?
Yeah.
See you, Tina.
Okay, thanks a lot, guys.
Thanks for your call.
Bye. Thanks for calling.
Bye-bye. Well, you know.
Male answer syndrome.
Yeah, well, we give wrong answers out all the time, too. So.
Yeah, but we get paid for it.
There you go.
No one was.
We're professionals.
We're professionals. This guy is just a rank amateur.
A rank amateur.
Rank amateur.
1-888-CAR-TALK. That's 888-227-8255. Hello, you're on Car Talk.
Hi, this is Jerry from Estes Park, Colorado.
Hi, Jerry with a G?
J.
With a J.
Yes.
What's up?
Well, I've got a 91 Pontiac Sunbird convertible.
Really?
My problem is putting the convertible top up and down. It seems that over a period of time, the motor has decided to sort of give up. And I've had to resort to a bit of a ballet to get the top up and down.
I know it well.
Yeah. At first, the motor worked fine. Then it got to the point where I had to tap on the motor. This motor is buried back inside the trunk.
Right.
And had a tap on it, and it would start running. Oh. Then it got to the point where we had to hold the button to raise the top and tap on the motor at the same time. So what I've been doing by myself is jamming a stick into one of the seats and having the other end hold the button down. then I run around to the back, tap on the motor with a stick, and I keep tapping on it.
Until
it starts running.
Yeah.
Then once it starts running, I run around to the side of the car, grab hold of the front edge of the top.
And help it up.
And help it, yes. I help it come back. Yeah. And then when it's all the way down, I can remove the stick that holds the button. I believe the trouble is in the electric motor.
Yeah, because if you can bang on the motor and it works, then...
Yeah, I think my brother's going to go out on a limb here and suggest that maybe the motor's no good.
Maybe the motor is no good. No, I'm just struck by the... I mean, it would seem that the obvious thing to do is replace the motor.
But
you have gone to these outrageous lengths to avoid doing that.
I had to do something until I could talk to you guys.
Yeah.
So how long have you been waiting to talk to us, Jerry?
It's been a while. So the question is this. Do you know if the hydraulic portion and the electric motor are one assembly, or is it possible to replace the motor, the electrical part only?
I would guess it's one piece, because it's not really a motor, it's a pump.
So the second question would be, would it be advisable to have the motor fixed or just to buy another one?
I would buy one.
I would go to a junkyard.
Ah.
And find one whose top goes up and down.
is this something that you would advise I have somebody replace as opposed to me trying
Absolutely
to get
it? Absolutely not. This is a job that's within your grasp, so to speak. Now, I think you should be able to replace just the motor. I mean, if you have to hit the motor to get it to run, it's likely that the motor is faulty. It probably has a bad brush or a bad commutator. And you, when you go to the junkyard, you'll see, or maybe you can crawl in your trunk and see how it goes together. Or better still, you could consult the repair manual.
Yeah.
Ah.
Ah.
I once had a 74 Chevy Caprice Classic convertible.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, the top didn't work. But you could. This wasn't easy because the top was huge and heavy. And you could hear everything happening, but it just didn't have the oomph.
That's right.
To make it go all the way up. So I devised, I had a hook that I hooked into the frame of the top. So the top is down, right? And it's down in the well there. And I put a hook there with a rope attached to it. So then I could stand up in the front seat and I could push the button with my foot and balance now, myself with my knee against the seat and pull on the rope, because you have to pull like straight up, so you couldn't do it sitting down.
Jerry, and you want our advice on what's wrong with this?
Well, I'll look into one of these salvage yards, see if I can find a convertible top that goes up and down, and see what I can do for the motor.
In the meantime, you may come to
the same conclusion that I did, which was, having the top up was not all it was cracked up to be, and I finally just decided to leave the top down.
I've got a nice full car cover.
Yeah,
I can throw them there overnight.
There you go.
I had the added advantage that I had huge holes in the floor, so that if it rained, the rain went right out. It was automatic drainage.
You're my kind of guy.
Hey, good luck, Jerry.
Thank you.
See you later.
Bye-bye.
Well, we were a lot of help.
But it's interesting. I mean, people have brand-new cars, and they're so worried about them. If you have a heap, there's a lot to be said for the freedom that you have.
Exactly my position. I've never felt so liberated as the first accident that I had with my Colt Vista.
Exactly. And you said, that's it. I remember I had this car when I was working on my doctoral dissertation. So I would work many, many hours.
You couldn't have
into
had
the
this
night.
Car that long.
I didn't have it that long during part of my doctoral dissertation. And I remember I used to be in my office typing away, working like mad. And the guy who worked on the custodian of the building used to run in and tell me, Tom, it's raining. Your top is down. And I'd say, yeah. He couldn't understand that.
Yeah, well,
he didn't have the freedom that I had.
Yeah, well, neither could we.
I knew I had a heap.
1-888-CAR-TALK. That's 888-227-8255. Hello, you're on Car Talk.
Hi, this is Klaus calling from Willimantic, Connecticut.
Hey, Klaus, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I didn't know there was a Willimantic. I always thought it was just a sign. No.
It's a town with a cute sort of ghost towny main street. And
really?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, what was it famous for?
Oh, it was famous for the American Thread Company that used to have its headquarters there, but they moved to some cheap labor country, and so
yeah,
it's not famous anymore.
Vermont. Anyway, Klaus, what's going on?
I have a '94 Saturn, and it's making a worrying sound. So when I go around corners, when I make left turns, there's a sound coming from the right front wheel area, and it's sort of this vibration, this grumbling sound. It goes
yeah,
and it only happens when I go around left turns.
Mm-hmm.
And it varies with the speed, so if I'm going slowly or if the turn isn't very sharp, there's no sound.
Why aren't all the questions like this?
This is a classic case of a bad constant velocity joint.
Oh, it's just a CV joint.
CV joint. The thing you just had replaced. No, you didn't, did you? No.
But you need one replaced. In fact, it's generally cheaper nowadays to replace the entire axle.
Uh-huh.
And what's wrong is the outer joint, which takes the abuse, is the one that's worn out.
Oh, I see.
I mean, okay. This is one of the big disadvantages of front-wheel drive cars, because that thing has to go, it's got to move up and down, because when you hit bumps, the wheel moves up and down.
Right.
It's got to turn left and right, and it's got to rotate at the same time. So it's a very complicated little piece of iron.
But, well, I'm working on an invention, a new constant velocity, John. I can't divulge anything. I hear you laughing, Klaus, but I'm working... Yeah. I'm working on a fluid coupling constant velocity joint.
You gave it away.
No, but I mean, I'm sure it's been thought of before.
Are rubber bands involved?
Oh, son of a...
there goes that great idea.
I figured how to execute it was the mystery, but we uncovered that. Well, anyway, Klaus, that's what you need.
A few $100 will do it.
Okay,
like five.
Can I do that myself? You know, I'm writing on my PhD thesis right now.
Oh, so you are?
Sure.
Yeah. You have a convertible?
No. No, it's not a convertible.
Well, you can do it yourself, but it does require that you remove the axle from the steering knuckle, and it's going to probably take some tools that you don't have.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So
there's a lot of pieces to take off.
Yeah, and then there's a matter of putting the axle into the transmission, which is a little tricky. And if you do it wrong, I would have it done by somebody.
Oh, okay.
Good luck.
Thank you very much.
See ya. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Okay, Tommy, are you ready for your puzzler hints, man?
Ready and willing. Shoot, man.
Okay, the first one's real easy. When anyone asks you to do any work, you show great blank.
Initiative.
Well, no, I was thinking resistance.
Oh, resistance.
Okay,
right.
Now name the one thing you are most afraid of.
My wife.
All right, and the second thing. I was looking for jumping out of an airplane.
Ah, that's second to being afraid of my wife.
This puzzler was about an American fighter pilot who parachuted out of his plane and was helped by the French Résistance.
Oh, yeah. Allons enfants de la
fa. Okay.
I go to work in a Saturn sedan.
And even though Martha Stewart gets a sudden brainstorm to create a new feature called Bad Things whenever she hears us say it, this is NPR. Hey, if you'd like to hear more Car Talk.
Yeah, like you're a parent and need a scared straight punishment for your kids.
You can download hundreds of classic Car Talk shows.
And by classic, we mean
old. Previously aired.
Exactly.
<you know.
laughs> Just go to cartalk.com and click where it says listen to the show. Hi, we're back. You're listening to Car Talk with us, Click and Clack, the Tappet Brothers, and we're here to talk about cars, car repair, and the answer to last week's puzzler. Now, this puzzler was historic, folkloric, cultural, and true, minus the obvious, I think I mentioned, misrepresentations, obfuscations, and lying. But I mean, other than that...
It was pretty straightforward.
It was pretty much true, I think.
Yeah.
I have it on good authority. Anyway, this took place during World War II. It seems that a young American fighter pilot had his plane shot up pretty badly, but before it crashed, he managed to parachute out, and he landed in northwest France outside a little village where he's discovered by the townspeople. They have to somehow get him back to his unit in England so he can continue to fly his missions to help liberate France from the grip of the Nazis.
Yes.
Did I put intriguing in here too? Historic, folkloric, cultural?
Intriguing.
Intriguing.
Yeah.
Anyway, so they remove all his clothing and discard it, including his shoes, his socks. They destroy his dog tags even. And they dress him up in typical French garb. Mm-hmm. You know, he's got a waist-length woolen jacket, a pair of sabots, a French beret, 2 or 3 days' growth of beard. So they make their way to the coast where other members of the resistance will be waiting to get him back to England across the channel. Mm. Their last night in France, they stop at a little inn to enjoy a little repast and some cognac. And while they're there, a group of German soldiers comes in.
Yeah.
One of the German soldiers scans the room. He's out of earshot of any of the people sitting at this table, and he points to this person and says, "That's the American." How did he know? Well, all the hints were there.
All the... And then some.
And then some?
I think we call them red herrings. Too many hints.
Too many hints?
I think this was too easy. But we'll see.
Well, what the German soldier observed is the members of the resistance and their would-be escapee dining.
Yeah, repast.
And while Americans traditionally cut their meat with the fork in the left hand and the knife in the right, when they go to eat that same cut meat or whatever, they transfer the fork to the right hand. And the Europeans, who can't wait to shovel it in, don't waste a second and will eat with the left hand. So when he saw this person swap...
Who looked and smelled like an authentic Frenchman.
swap the fork to his right hand.
Yeah, that
was the kiss of death. Kiss of death.
Literally.
So who's our winner?
That was a beauty. And the winner this week is Matt Lewis from Santa Fe, New Mexico. And for having his answer selected at random from all the correct answers that we got, Matt's going to get a $26 gift certificate to our Shameless Commerce division. And with that $26, he can pick up a copy of our music CD called Car Talk Cartoons Volume 1, the Car Talk Compendium of Disrespectful Car Songs. Why do we mention that? He could get any kind, all kinds of things.
No, we're trying to get rid of these now.
Is that it? Well, you can play this in your car, and it'll make that long summer road trip seem even longer than it is. At least that's been my experience, although your results may vary.
Exactly right. Anyway, I believe we have a brand new puzzler coming up in the third half of the show.
Oh, you're not sure if it's coming up, or you're not sure it's brand new?
I'm not sure of anything.
You're not sure it's a puzzler.
So don't give up on us right now, because you never know what's going to happen. But if you'd like to call us, the number is 888-CAR-TALK. That's 888-227-8255. Hello, you're on Car Talk.
Hi, this is Kyle from Lake Mittagoshi in North Dakota.
Lake Mittagoshi. You got to spell that for me.
Okay, here we go. Yeah. Mettigoshe.
Excellent.
Mittagoshi.
Mittagoshi.
Yeah.
Lake Mittagoshi.
Cool.
So what's up?
Well, here's my story.
Yeah.
I just got married over Christmas.
Cool.
And wonderful wife, beautiful person to be with, but along with that is a car that has potential problems. And she has a wonderful family. I have a wonderful family. And when we got married, my dad didn't think, you know, she's a beautiful person, wonderful person. He thought, great, we get another car to change the oil on over Thanksgiving vacation.
Oh, one of those, huh?
He loves changing oil.
Yeah.
But here's what happened. A couple weeks ago, we had to get a new front wheel bearing. We were told we need one.
Kyle, I have to interrupt for a second. We've been doing this show for close on to 20 years. And our producer has told my brother 1,000 times, if you're going to drink a can of Coke, don't open it up during
underneath the show,
in the vicinity of the microphone. Try to open it like before the show,
people
or if you must open
people
it.
People think you're passing wind. I'm glad you straightened that out, because a lot of people might have thought it was you.
Well, that's why I interrupted Kyle's little narrative, because I wanted to set the record straight, but I'm sorry. Go ahead, Kyle.
Well, I just want to point out that if you hadn't shaken the can for 20 minutes...
I didn't shake it.
Before
you... It fell down a flight of stairs.
Oh, man.
This wouldn't have happened.
Well, it fell up a flight of stairs, if you can figure that one out.
It happens. Oh, I know it happens.
Geez. All right, Kyle.
All right. So your father likes to change the oil.
Your father.
Yeah,
your
exactly.
father, right.
My father. But we had to get a new wheel bearing in the front tire, and that was fine. But then my father-in-law, Al, he went and bought my wife 4 new tires on her car.
Mm.
So, but the mechanic told him that we need to get the wheel bearings packed.
Rear wheel bearings.
Yes.
Yeah.
On her 92 Pontiac Grand Am. So mm-hmm. he told Betsy, my wife, and Betsy told me. Then I called my dad, and he said, no, you cannot pack wheel bearings on the back of a Grand Am. You just can't do that. So here's my problem. I mean, one of them is right and one of them is wrong, and I just don't know how to deal with it.
Oh.
Because both of them are very good with cars, or claim to be.
Well, I think your father, if he said that the wheel bearings cannot be repacked, is he the one that made that statement?
Yes, that's what
I think
said.
He's correct.
That was Kyle's father who said that.
I think these are sealed for life bearings, or 25,000 miles, whichever comes first. So I don't believe that these bearings are repackable.
Right.
Back in the old days, wheel bearings used to come apart, and they would be, it would consist of an inner bearing with a race and a seal behind that, and then an outer bearing with its race, and then a lock nut and a cotter pin, and then a cap, a grease cap that fit over that whole thing. So you
sure.
got the picture? And you could take that cap off, pull the cotter pin, extract the bearings, clean out all the gunk that's in there, put new grease in, and then torque the retaining nut to the right amount and put everything back together. But I don't believe that the Grand Am has that setup. It has a preloaded bearing that comes from the factory, and the thing is just bolted on with the hub assembly.
Sure.
So if it's loose, it means the bearing needs to be replaced.
Okay.
And if you want to find out for sure, you can call a parts store and ask
okay.
them what that rear wheel bearing looks like. If the guy says, oh, it's all one piece, then you know
then
it doesn't
get repacked.
It doesn't get repacked, right.
But now I'm nervous to tell my father-in-law that he wasn't right, telling me that we had to do that.
I mean, is this going to crush him to find this out?
No, it won't crush him. But I might not get anything for Christmas this year.
I would keep it all quiet.
Okay. I might just figure out myself.
Just figure out what has to be done.
Well, more importantly, I would take it someplace and have them check, because if the bearing really is loose, then it needs to be replaced.
Okay.
Yeah, and don't mess around with that, because when bearing seize, it's not pretty.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
See you, Kyle.
Good
Thanks
luck,
for calling.
Kyle.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
1-888-CAR-TALK. That's 888-227-8255. Hello, you're on Car Talk.
Hello, this is Kim. I'm calling from Barrington, Rhode Island.
Barrington, Rhode Island.
That's right. And I have a 90 Jetta, and when I turn on the air conditioner or the defroster, white smoke blows into the car.
Where are you, on Route 95?
You're not driving, I hope.
No, I'm afraid to drive my car now, so no. Now I'm riding my bicycle
White
everywhere.
Smoke pours out, but only for a few seconds.
Does it stop?
No, it doesn't. It doesn't stop. I mean, I actually did leave it on with the windows open, trying to, you know, clear out whatever it was, and it doesn't really stop.
And it happens every time you turn on the air conditioner?
Yes.
And does it smell?
Yes, it smells.
It smells sweet?
It smells sweet.
Oh!
Yes. You're a genius.
No, we're not
geniuses. How do you know that?
No.
It does smell sweet.
It can be. It's usually one of two things. One of them is completely benign. And then yours. The completely benign thing is that sometimes when it's very humid, what looks like smoke that's coming out of the air conditioner vents is actually you're making clouds.
Exactly.
It's water vapor.
Do you think it will rain inside?
And you could have a little rain. You could have a little posh.
Exactly. But you can forget about that, because
that ain't what you got.
No. What you have instead is a leaky heater core.
And so what's happening is you're blowing the air, it's cold, and it's taking the leaking antifreeze and blowing it into your car and probably poisoning you. Have you noticed your loss of memory, dizziness?
I have.
Inability to focus?
Yes, getting progressively less intelligent.
Yeah, unable to make, you know, rational decisions. Yeah.
Making strange calls to people on the radio.
Talking to strange people on the telephone.
How long has it been doing this, actually?
Well, a long time, since last summer.
Oh, that's bad.
Yeah, it's...
Well, it's bad because you may be out of antifreeze.
And you need to get it addressed.
And before you drive the car again, you really should check to see if there's any fluid in the radiator.
I check it.
You do?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And has it been down consistently?
Sometimes it's down and sometimes it's not. It seems to be...
Yeah.
Yeah, no,
you know,
so you
no
add periodically
to it.
Yeah.
Yes.
And
that's good.
That's good. But eventually you're going to lose your ability to reason.
Yeah.
Can't I just take out the heater core and live without heat in the winter?
Yes, you can do that.
You can do that.
It's not that cold here.
It's not that cold in Rhode Island?
No, not really.
Well, not now it isn't.
Well,
no.
The answer is yes, you can do that. You would not actually remove the heater core, because if you went to the trouble of removing it, you would have already done all the work practically.
You're just
going to
replace
it.
You're going to shunt the hoses together.
Like a bypass.
We're going to do a bypass. Exactly.
Right.
Okay.
You're all set, Kim, baby.
Thank you very much.
Take care.
That's good news.
Thanks for your call. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Hey, do you know what time it is now?
Time to fertilize and weed your beard?
No. It's time to play Stump the Chumps. All right. So which caller are we, as we say, revisiting this week? And have they been paid off in advance to make us look good? We should pay off.
I thought it was your turn to pay. Oh, well, our contestant today is Elisa from Charleston, South Carolina. Elisa didn't really have a car problem. She had an ethical dilemma involving a car, her boyfriend, and her parents.
Oh, I love it. I vaguely remember her.
Go ahead.
Hey, well, the thing is, I have been living with a man for a while now. We are in a committed relationship, although we are not married.
Yeah. We call that what? Living in sin.
Living in sin.
Okay. Just want to set the record straight.
The problem is,
but you share no matrimonial vows, my child.
That's right. And my parents want us to get married.
We're ministers, by the way.
We can do this on the air.
They want us to get married badly enough that they've offered to buy us a new car if we do it.
Oh.
Do you think that I should do it? That's why I'm calling you, for advice.
Have they bribed you at any other time in the past?
Well, no, I didn't really think of it as a bribe. I thought of it
You didn't think of it as a bribe?
But it isn't a bribe for her. It's
no.
He's the one being bribed.
Yeah, it's clear to me now.
More important.
He has a car.
Well, I know, but more important than anything, he's going to want to marry you for you.
That's what he says.
And not the car.
That's what he says.
Unless it's a Q45. But if he doesn't love you, I thought we acquitted ourselves pretty well there. If I remember correctly, we got the boyfriend on the phone and we told him in no uncertain terms to wait and get married when they're good and ready, not when the parents want them to. The hell with the car.
Well, I'm having second thoughts about it. I mean, marriages come and they go, but a free car? I mean, where can you get a deal like that?
Taking the car would have been wrong. We told them that if they took the car, they'd wonder for the rest of their lives whether they married for love or for the Lexus.
It is tough to resist that temptation. Well, we're going to find out what happened. Elisa, are you there?
I'm here.
God love you.
Now, Elisa, before you give us the dramatic conclusion to this story of true love versus material gratification, we have to establish that the answer you're about to give here today on Stump the Chumps has in no way been influenced by any promises of cash or prizes from us or National Public Radio or your parents or anything else. Is that true?
No influences at all.
No influence. All right. What'd you do?
Well, we got married in April.
Oh, isn't that sweet?
How cute.
But the real question is, did you take the car from your parents?
Well, yes.
So, I mean,
you ignored our advice, basically.
Yes.
Yes.
No, I didn't ignore your advice.
Yeah, you did.
I was going to get a car anyway. It turned out that my parents were determined to buy me a new vehicle, and they were just...
And they just wanted to make sure that you nailed a husband at the same time.
I think that might have been a little bit of it, yeah.
I don't know whether we should play the right music or the wrong music here.
I don't know either.
I mean, we suggested that you not take the car under any circumstances.
No, you didn't tell me that. I think you told Tracy that. You told me to marry him if I wanted to marry him.
Right, okay. But we did tell Tracy that...
I wanted to marry him, but I wanted the car, too.
Yeah.
Well, we know that. I wanted the car, too, but I didn't get one.
Well, did you... What'd you get, anyway?
Brand new Ford Explorer.
Oh. Well, somebody's a winner. Might not be us, but somebody won.
I don't think we're winners here. So you got a brand new Ford Explorer, and you've been married now for a couple of months.
Right.
And are you and Tracy ecstatically happy?
Well, I'm driving a new Ford Explorer.
Well, we know where you're at. Boy, that car was important, I guess.
Well, Elisa, I wish you the very, very best, and I hope you're married for 100 years at least.
Okay, well.
And I hope you have the marriage... A lot longer than you have the Explorer.
Well, I hope so, too.
See ya.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thanks a lot. If you happen to hear someone you'd like us to bring back for Stump the Chumps, you can email us your suggestions from cartalk.com.
All right, look, before we take any more calls, I think we have to give out the new puzzler. And before we give out the new puzzle, we have to do what?
Steel ourselves, gather up our strength.
And to do that, we need what?
Brains.
And what else?
More coffee.
You got it. We'll be back with the new puzzler and more of your calls in just a minute, so don't go away. You can call me a car lover, 'cause I love it in a motor. And the way it feels, And even though tow truck drivers complain that we're soiling the industry's image whenever they hear us say it, this is NPR. Ha! We're back. You're listening to Car Talk with us, Click and Clack, the Tappert Brothers, and we're here to discuss cars, car repair, and the new Puzzler.
Yeah, I can hardly wait.
Oh, gee. See, with a ringing endorsement like
no,
that.
No, no, I'm going to be, am I your brother? Would I let you down? I'll just remind you of one thing. Bo. No, but right, I'm sure it'll be fine.
Try to use your imagination.
I'm sure it'll be good. Go ahead.
There'd been an accident on the Upper Canyon Road. A middle-aged driver in a European sports car evidently lost control in the early morning hours and plunged 100 feet to his death. Even though he wore his seatbelt and the airbag now deflated had obviously deployed, neither could have prevented the broken neck that ended his life. The police detective called to the scene began to study the evidence. He slowly removed the dead man's sunglasses, admiring them and thinking to himself how nice it would be to own a fancy pair of designer glasses like these. He put them on and looked at himself in the driver's side view mirror. Nice, but not my prescription, he thought. He removed them and carefully placed them on the dashboard. He stared at the dead man's face. He obviously hadn't shaved that morning. He noticed the deep impression those sunglasses had made on the bridge of his nose, the obvious result of the tremendous force created by the exploding airbag.
Yeah.
He stared intently into the dead man's blue-green eyes and thought how peaceful he looked and how his relaxed countenance belied the obvious terror of his last few moments on Earth. He slowly rose from his uncomfortable, crouching position. He summoned one of the officers to the scene. Dust for prints. Yeah. This is a homicide. What did he see? What did he know? Now, if you think you know the answer, write it on a postcard or on the back of a $21 bill. And send it to Puzzler
this
Tower.
This inflation is really ruining
it's
things
killing
for
us. It's making the accounting department go crazy. Send your answer to Puzzler Tower, Car Talk Plaza, Box 3500, Harvard Square, Cambridge.
Our fair city.
Matt 02238. Or you can email us your answer, of course, from cartalk.com. But right now, if you have a question about your car or anything, but preferably your car, give us a call at 888-CAR-TALK. That's 888-227-8255. Hello, you're on Car Talk.
Hey, guys. This is Valerie from Rescue, California.
From Rescue? Like Rescue Me?
Like Rescue Me, please.
Where's Rescue?
We are at the base of the Sierra foothills, about an hour away from Tahoe.
Oh, I've been there.
Oh, and what is the strange reason for the name of this place?
You know, I don't really know.
You
know
don't
that...
know?
Are there lots of, skulls and crossbones? And...
Yeah, what's so dangerous that you have
the
to
whole place
rescue
is there. It's a desert.
You know, I heard that there was a story that some guy was in a situation, either in a fire or he was drowning or something, and then there was a big team that came and rescued him, and that's why they named it Rescue. But don't quote me on that.
So were you born and raised in Rescue?
No. I've only been here a couple of years.
Oh, okay. So You're excused. Anyway, what's going on, Valerie?
Well, thanks for calling.
Yeah, see ya. About 6 months ago, I was really ticked off at my husband.
Wow.
And I got into our 1995 Ford F-250 and raced down this country road that we live on and got a bed full of hay because we have some horses. And then I raced back and hit a pothole, and the truck just stopped. I mean, the transmission just stopped. The engine was still going, but the whole transmission just froze up.
What do you mean it said it froze? Did it just like you slammed the brakes on?
No, it just started making this whirring noise.
Yeah, yeah. Remember back now to the first leg of the trip.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, by the way, have you patched things up with him?
Oh, yeah.
This didn't help.
No. We're fine. He had to come. We have another Ford F-250, but it's an older one, and he had to come down the road, unload the hay out of the broken truck. And
oh,
put
I'm
it
sure he was just thrilled to do that.
But how did he know you were down there unable to move?
Well, I had my cell phone with me.
Ah,
So you called him on your cell phone. You said, "Hun."
Not exactly.
And he said, "Who's this?"
I said, "Get your butt down here."
And he said, "I'll be right there." 4 hours later, he showed up. So you offloaded the hay onto his truck.
Right.
And then you towed this one yourselves.
Well, we called a tow truck.
And they towed it to your ranch.
To our property, yes.
Well, here's my best guess.
Okay.
How mad were you?
Was he mad at you, or were you mad at him, or both?
I was mad at him.
Ah.
Yeah.
Okay, well, it may be completely...
Wait, what did he do?
You know, I don't remember.
I'm trying to learn something here.
Oh, I'm hopeless.
He and I were talking about it last night. I said, "What was I mad at you for?" He says, "I don't know." I said, "I don't know either." So,
well, you know, that's a great kind of argument to have, because when you can't remember, it means you can't hold a grudge.
That's right.
That's good. Anyway.
Where were we?
Here's my guess.
Okay.
I think you ruptured one of the transmission cooler lines.
Okay.
There are metal lines that run from the transmission up to the radiator, and there's a coil inside the radiator that allows that hot transmission fluid to get cooled off by the not-quite-so-hot coolant or antifreeze.
Oh,
you
okay.
probably broke one of these lines. Don't forget, the thing is 1,000 years old. It could have just fallen off. It could have bouncing down the road like you were doing on
she
this.
You did hit a pothole.
You probably hit more than a few potholes. You were probably cursing. God knows what you're doing.
Good.
And
you act like you know me.
And maybe you were going a little faster than you should have, and you may have hit something, and just the bouncing may have sheared one of those lines. And while you were driving, you were losing transmission fluid. Until finally you got to the point where you lost enough of it that all that you could get out of the transmission instead of locomotion was a whir.
Right, okay.
So now you may have lunched the transmission, because transmissions don't like to run with very low fluid, and they definitely don't like to run with no fluid.
Right.
Fill it up with transmission fluid. You know, it may take you 5 quarts or so to get some read on how big the leak is.
Okay.
Start the thing up, and you'll see where the leak is. When you see that, shut it off immediately and repair the leak. And you can fix it either by buying a new cooler line from the dealer, or you can just make a line out of rubber hose, at least enough to get you to the repair shop.
Okay.
At that point, fill the thing up with the correct amount of fluid and drive it. If the transmission won't shift, then not only do you need transmission cooler lines, but you need a transmission.
Yeah. Uh-oh.
So no one's looked underneath. I mean, it could be that you put a big honking hole in the transmission with that boulder that you didn't tell us about.
My brother-in-law did look underneath it.
Oh, he did?
He said that it looked okay. And he said it could be something that fell off or something loose or something. So maybe it's what you guys said.
Well, it could be. I mean, there's a possibility that somehow or another the thing shifted into neutral. You know, the linkage came disconnected, and the only whirring you're getting is what you'd get if you were in neutral.
In neutral. Yeah, that's
so
what it sounds like.
Check the fluid.
Okay.
If there's fluid in there, then, you know, it could be that the linkage fell off, and that'd be easy to fix.
Okay.
You know, and bouncing up and down through potholes and hitting boulders, that can do that too.
Yeah.
Just try to keep your emotions in check from now on, Valerie.
I am trying, guys.
All right.
I really am.
Next time, take a pill or something. See you later.
Bye-bye.
Bye. 888.
She's an interesting person because
she
can get mad as hell. We know that. But she can laugh at the same time almost.
Yeah, almost. 6 months later. 888-CAR-TALK. That's 888-227-8255. Hello, you're on Car Talk.
Hi. My name is Howard. I'm calling from Randolph, Ma. And
how
I
you
have
doing?
A question that's automotive and aeronautical and has a folkloric form.
Yeah, excellent. I love it already.
All right, we're ready, Howard.
How do you keep a mattress on the roof of your car from flying?
Yeah, well, I don't know how many people know it, but a lot of people have learned that putting your arm up there to hold the mattress is not going to work. I mean, how many times have you seen guys start out with one guy driving?
I mean, no rope.
No rope. Just an arm.
Yeah.
Thinking that they can hold onto that mattress. Au contraire.
Well, even the ones that are tied up, you know, where you run the, we've always done is we've run the ropes with the doors open across the mattress and then tied it up as best we could.
Yeah.
And then you close the doors when you get in the car, which is preferable to tying them up with the doors closed and having to climb in the windows. But most people don't know what that mattress is doing when they're going down the highway at 70 miles an hour. The front of that thing is
it's flipped 90
up
degrees.
Like the front of Dwayne Doberman's, you know, hat. And it doesn't take much for that thing to flip right off.
Yeah. Not only that, it's probably giving enough lift to the front of the car that you could lose control.
Well, exactly. I mean, you know, you get the speed up to stall speed?
Lift speed.
Lift speed, and you could take those wheels right off the ground.
I wouldn't be surprised.
But I take it you've had personal experience with mattressing?
I have a car top carrier that I built. It sits about 3 inches off the roof, you know, on suction cups and a metal bracket. And I've tried, you know, putting that on the car and then roping the mattress to that.
Yeah.
But I still get lift. And what I figured out finally, what I need to do is get negative lift.
Yeah.
Negative lift.
How are you going to do that?
Well, there's got to be a way of shaping it, right?
Well,
Bernoulli's principle and all that.
If you had, someone should be making, if they don't already. Of course they don't. But I can visualize a device which you place over the front of the mattress.
Ooh,
after.
I got it.
You have tied it to the roof.
A mattress spoiler.
A mattress spoiler, exactly.
Yes, I figured that out, but what shape should it be?
What are we, aeronautical engineers? Oh, you said this was an aeronautical question.
Yeah.
You got to call aeronautical talk.
No, I think you need to make, you know what?
Did you take 201? You took 2001.
I took 201. I took 202. I took 201 again. You need... You know what a spoiler looks like on the, you know, you see them on the back of sports cars and race cars. What if you were to take one of these things, you ready for this, and mount it to a piece of plywood?
Of course.
Okay, and then that piece of plywood, you...
See, I was thinking more of it, something that would clamp onto the mattress. If you could take that spoiler off the back of the car and put two big clamps on it, boom, so that it clamps onto the mattress and the front of the mattress, then all that air that you're making at 60 miles an hour is going to just go straight through the spoiler, up and over the mattress.
Do you move a lot of mattresses, Howard? I mean, what?
I have this one mattress I'm moving up to Hunga Dunga.
Yeah, see, that's the problem.
And I'm going over the interstate.
Yeah. I think you have to start fashioning the spoiler.
Well, I'll tell you what. If I make it up successfully with a spoiler, I'll send you guys a picture.
Yeah. You remind me of a very funny story. You know what I'm thinking, don't you?
I do.
This friend of ours, he had an old car. It was one of those 80s big GM cars. And he worked late at night. One night, he's driving by a construction site. And it's late. It's 2 o'clock in the morning, and he sees a bunch of 4x8 sheets of plywood. It so happens that his brother-in-law is doing a little construction job.
And needs 20 sheets.
He could use a dozen or so sheets of 4x8 plywood. So this guy...
Half-inch seat, the exterior grade. They just happen to fit the bill.
He says, who's going to miss them? So he stops his car, and under cover of darkness, he piles up half a dozen of these sheets of plywood on his roof, except he has nothing to tie them with. So he says, if I drive really slowly, where are they going to go? So he piles up, I don't know, half a dozen sheets of 4x8 plywood, quarter inch, half inch stuff. And he's not too far from his friend's house. He's going to drive to his friend's house, his brother-in-law, it turned out to be, and he's going to pile them up in the guy's yard. So he very carefully starts up and drives very, very slowly.
No, at this time he has about 18 sheets, if I remember the
Did
story.
He?
18
really?
Sheets on the roof.
18 sheets is a foot and a half of plywood. He says, oh boy, is going to love me.
18 sheets is 9 inches. It was just enough that he could reach up with his hand, thinking that holding these sheets is going to prevent them from going anywhere.
Anyway, he's doing really well. It's 2 o'clock in the morning. There's no traffic except for that one car that cuts him off almost. He slams on the brake. All 18 sheets of plywood come forward and rip off the entire front of his car, the hood, the grill,
the headlights,
the whole thing. And he's sitting there at the intersection with 18 sheets of plywood on the street.
And $1,000 worth of damage.
$1,000 worth of damage. And you know his first words were. Oh, man. It doesn't get any better.
So, Howard, tie it down carefully, but work on the spoiler. I think you may have an idea.
Okay. Thank you.
Good luck.
Thanks for calling.
Bye-bye.
I mean, the visual imagery is so good.
Yeah. Yeah, I think they said they came down like one sheet at a time. He said it was like, it was surreal. It was like slow motion. And as he saw the headlights and the grill getting sheared off, he just couldn't believe it. Oh, boy. Well, it's happened again. You diddled away another perfectly good hour listening to Car Talk. Our esteemed producer is Doug, the subway fugitive, not a slave to fashion, bongo boy, frog man, pumpkin lips, cute, 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 Berman. Our associate producers are David, the calves of Belleville Green, and Catherine Frau Blucher Fenelosa. Our web lackey is Doug, the old gray mare, assisted by Connie Bridgeford. Our engineer is John Cartman Parati. Our theme music is by David Dog Grisman, and our technical, spiritual, and menu advisor, just back from the Tippecanoe, rabbit stew, tiramisu, Mountain Dew, Charleston Chew, and roast beef au jus, howdy do, is John Bugsy Lawler. Our public opinion pollster is Paul Murky of Murky Research, assisted by statistician Marge Overa. Our customer care representative is Haywood Jabuzoff. Our personal makeup artist is Bud Tugley. Our parts inventory manager is Wayne DeBack. Our sidewalk clothing vendor is Chip Pence.
Wayne DeBack.
Our tolerance quality control guy is Nat Sass. Our ornithologist in training is Luke A. Boyd. Luke A. Boyd. Our ornithologist in training is Luke A. Boyd. Our official spokesperson is Howie Vasive. Our big band leader is One and a Two. The pre-recorded portions of today's show were selected by staff librarian, all been heard before. Our Russian chauffeur is Bikoff and Dropoff, and our staff tailor is you, Jess. Our chief counsel from the law firm of Dewey, Cheetham & Howe is you, Louis Dewey, known to the ascot-wearing alums in Harvard Square as Huey Louie Dewey. Thanks so much for listening. We're Click and Clack, the Tappert Brothers, and remember, above all, and don't forget,
yeah,
don't drive like my brother.
You got it.
We'll be back next week. Bye-bye. You can get a podcast of this show, which is number 1422, download classic Car Talk episodes, and check out our clothing and CD collections all over at cartalk.com. This week at cartalk.com, an insider's tour of our actual garage.
I thought we imposed a no cameras rule after that little visit we had from the Attorney General.
Well, where do you think we got the photos? They're from the Attorney General's website.
Check out the candid shots of our garage all this week at cartalk.com.
Car Talk is a production of Dewey, Cheetham & Howe and WBUR in Boston.
And even though Robert Siegel wonders if they still need that night manager at the Piggly Wiggly whenever he hears us say it, this is NPR.